On my mission to up the cool factor of the Pacer, the first job is to drop the suspension. And there's one place to start. Now, my plan for the front suspension, at least, is to replace that rather tall spring with one that's shorter by about 50mm or 2 inches in old money. Changing a spring might sound simple, but the suspension is a complex mass of parts, all held under tension. And before I tackle that tough nut, I have to remove the brake caliper, which throws up a surprise. Now, this is really interesting. I've never seen a caliper that goes together quite like this before. You can see, obviously, the moving part of the caliper and then the carrier here, but it's actually attached to the carrier rather than with bolts, but just really this little wedge here. That wedge holds everything together. Once it's been drifted out, then hopefully the caliper should just slide out of position. Very clever, very simple. Eventually, I get decent access to the old spring, but it's under massive load and would be impossible to compress by hand. So I build a tool myself from a bit of square-cut thread studding, a plate, and a couple of nuts. Okay, so now our plate is actually bolted into position onto the bottom suspension arm. Well, that's going to stop the whole thing rotating, so our bottom nut is effectively fixed. When I turn the top nut, because that's welded to the studding, that's like a bolt, is actually going to wind the two together, therefore it's going to compress the spring and take up the strain. I'll just take up the slack, actually, there we go. Now I'm just going to do a couple of quarter turns. There we go. So now the spring and the bottom suspension arm are supported, I can actually start disconnecting the suspension. The lower suspension is connected to the subframe with four eccentric washers. If I don't refit them exactly as found, I could seriously upset the handling. So I'm marking the positions of each washer and subframe with a centre pot before removal. It really has to be precise. Now, with the nut removed from the back of this bolt, I can now actually move the bolt at this end, and you can see quite clearly that even a small amount of movement of this eccentric washer actually moves the suspension by quite a considerable amount. So you can see why it's so important that it goes back in exactly the same position. Fitted incorrectly and you mess with the camber, risking poor handling or an accident, as the suspension geometry will be compromised. Finally, all the suspension is released and I should be able to get at the spring. Now, this is still under a bit of tension, so I'm going to be very careful. Stand way back. There we are. So now, all I have to do is undo our top bolt and it should come away. And there we go, one spring.
And it's time for the new springs.
These have been made to my specification. Now, they're going to end up making the car 50 millimetres lower, but obviously it's also much stiffer, so it's going to tighten up the way the car drives, which it really does rather need.
There's a myth that you can just cut down your old springs, but it's not true. In fact, it's dangerous. Springs have flattened ends and a spring rate designed to guarantee a certain travel and performance. Cut them down and you'll never get a flat enough end to get good location in the suspension arm, and you'll damage the ride of the car. Last thing to go in is the shock absorber, and that's the front done. The rear's a very different story.
The front suspension's done, the rear is going to be nice and easy. As you can see, the axle sits on top of the leaf spring, so all you have to do to lower the car is actually lift that up, pop in some kind of spacer between the axle and the spring, and job done. Now, the axle's held in place by a great big U-bolt here, so all you need is a block and a longer U-bolt. Now, thankfully, Mike has found me exactly that, so all I have to do is take this apart and then reassemble it with this in position.
The spacer will force the axle up and the cart spring down, bringing the wheel closer into the arch. The new, longer U-bolts will lock it all into place.
So we've managed to separate the axle from the spring. Thankfully, it wasn't too hard. So now I can actually insert the block that Mike got me. We have a problem. The axle needs to be located by the top of the block, and you can see there's a big kind of slot in here and a small peg there.
The spacer has been fouled underneath by this bottom peg too. A poor fit is dangerous as the axle will be loose in the suspension. bad news is I can't continue. I need a custom part, which might cost a lot.
So, I guess it's back to Mike. See if he can sort that out. Well, here is our new aluminium spacer block that Mike has had made. Hopefully this one will actually fit. It's looking good. Look at that. Like a glove.
With the spacer in place, all I need to do is fit the extended U-bolts and clamp it all together. The suspension drop is done, and finally, we can check out how low it's going to go.
Well, that has made a massive difference. The car is now much more purposeful. It's almost aggressive and racy. So now the Nerdmobile is no more, and finally, our pacer is on the pace. Getting top dollar for this pacer means making sure everything's running 100% right. Little faults can actually scare potential buyers away, which is why Mike's asked me to try and sort out the problem with the gear selector display.
The broken display means you might end up in reverse when you think you're in neutral, with obviously devastating results. It's a basic safety issue which needs fixing. It seems as though there's a simple cable which runs from the steering column mounted gear stick up to the indicator. And with all the panels removed, I can start fishing for the fault.
It's not easy to see what's going on there, but I can see a kind of cable or wire. I try and pull that. There we go, look at that, straight away. We've got our display going backwards and forwards, but clearly there's some kind of brake. This is obviously going to be attached ordinarily to our column here. Just grab a mirror, have a look. There's like a hook that's sort of screwed to the column with a sort of adjuster. But also the wire's got a kink in it, and I reckon that might be where it's kind of double backed on itself around the hook, and of course that's what's going to connect the two ends together.
The original cable has a loop at each end, and it seems as though at one end the crimp has given way.
Now, the thing is, I don't really know why it broke or why it wasn't actually connected, so just to play it on the safe side, I'm going to replace it with one made from brand new materials. I've got some fishing line here. It's actually quite tough. It's like 60 pounds breaking strain, or 27 kilograms. And I'm just going to basically make it up using these little crimp sleeves here, one at either end. And the idea is we'll end up with a finished product that'll be very, very strong and should outlive, well, hopefully, the life of the car.
I've used the old one as a template to get exactly the right length.
Well, this is our new cable. I've got to try and feed it through the various bits of the dashboard.
It's a fiddly and frustrating process. The next step is to use another fisherman's friend.
Now, I'm going to try and use the hook to get it from there to the next stage, which will be across to our indicator stalk.
The good thing is, if it works, the total part spend will be just $10, 6 quid. Mike will be very chuffed I've hooked a big saving for the budget.
There you go, so that's now in position, which is cool. So now the last thing to do is try and attach the bottom, put it down here. Okay, so everything's connected up. So we've got park, reverse, neutral, drive, second and first. Fantastic, it all works beautifully. So it's a nice, cheap fix, but a real pain to do.
Click here to subscribe.